professional boxing has always fed like a glutton on the seamy side of life. A crushed cheekbone, a bruised face, bloodied bodies, vicious knockouts, unfixed fights, and ruthless gamblers. It has flourished amid the howling fans and the stench of expensive cigars and cheap cigarettes, stale beer, and fresh sweat. The combatants, toe-to-toe, gladiators and prize fighters, punching for whatever it is.
I think, in the 20th century, boxing and baseball, up at least until the end of World War II, that was where it was at. And I think that boxing was something, whether you were in Goldfield, Nevada, or Madison Square Garden in New York, something the whole country knew about. And then when radio came along in the 1920s, boxing became part of the American culture.
Long before any of the Fulmer brothers climbed through the ropes and into the boxing ring, their stiff-necked, leathery toughness was being cast from a hard-bitten lifestyle up there on Rattlesnake Flat in Bingham Canyon. All the right ingredients for a champion.
Saturday nights when they'd go to the dances, Sunday morning, we'd try to get Dad up for priesthood. You know, he'd have a black eye almost every Sunday. He probably knocked the other guy cold, but he got a black eye in the process. But yeah, being tough, I think Dad set kind of the stage, you know, for Gene. I mean, they named Gene after Gene Tooney. All that, it just kind of built in, you know, kind of a fighting family right from the start.
Well, Dad was great people. They taught us some good principles, work hard. Dad was taught us how to work. You know, we had to work on the farm, and of course we worked during the summer times all the time, hauling hay, topping beets, weeding beets, thinning beets. So we had to work just about our whole life, you know, and that was good. You know, it taught us how to work. Mom and Dad taught us, you know, work is very important. They taught us the right things.
Well, I think I was raised very gentle. Basically, my father never had touched me about doing something wrong. I mean, he would tell me, but never did he ever touch me with spanking or anything of that sort. My mother was a little different. She didn't mind spanking and keeping me under control a little bit. But my dad had a great personality, and although his nickname was Tough, he didn't necessarily live up to it. And that with me, he lived up to it with a lot of other people in the world, but never with me.
The plodding, stilted way of life was commonplace in those days. Eke out a living in the mines and on the farms. Tough and Mary Fulmer never blinked with that challenge. Instead, they made a special pact, a bond, the way struggling families shake their fist against the wind. Marv Jensen was the consummate boxing manager, trainer, and corner man. Suave, savvy, self-assured, always with a knowing grin. And it was his simple ploy in those early years that gave his young stable of boxers something to fight for.
Thank you, Governor. It's really a pleasure to come here today and see all my old friends. Any success I've ever had is you're a part of it, all of you. Just say that this is as much a day for Margaret, too. She's had all the kids in the place that our home's been the home for the whole country, the whole town.
Jean and Jay and Don were all boxing at the same time, and Marv Jensen was their manager. And he had rules for him to be able to belong to the West Jordan Boxing Club. The rules were no smoking, no drinking, no swearing. Mind your mom and dad and have respect.
And Jay has instilled that in his club now, that the kids, and they all come from 8 years on up.
I think it's been a very missionary type sport, the way we did it as a family, because there was nothing, you know, no smoking, no drinking, no whatever. And that started right out with Marv when we were little kids starting out for his gym. There'll be no smoking, there'll be no drinking, there'll be no swearing, you go to church. If you don't, we'll take back your sweater. And I told you before, we give us a sweater. And then they take it off if that happened. Well, we all kept our sweaters, so if that tells you anything, why, that's the reason.
And I think for the former brothers to come into that kind of experience, they're not big men, they're feisty fellows. It's a tough world. And obviously Jensen saw something in them, they saw something in him, and it had a pretty magical relationship.
If they fought five times and abide by all the rules, I got a beautiful sweater.
Gene Fulmer got a sweater, and his boxing journey was underway.
Introducing from West Jordan, Utah, weighing 157 and a quarter, the challenger, Gene Fulmer. Fulmer!
He rolled through the amateur ranks, turned pro in 1951, and at just 19 years of age, plowed his way to 28 straight wins, 23 by knockout.
Oh, good right hand. Gene Fulmer nails his man.
If you're talking Fulmers, you've got to start with Gene. He's the big brother. He's our hometown hero. He's the one who brought home the middleweight championship of the world, defeating the all-time great pound-for-pound best fighter in the history of the sport. Even Muhammad Ali said, Sugar Ray is the best. I might be the greatest, but Ray Robinson is the best. Gene beat him in 1957. Ever since then, he has been our hero here. When you talk Utah boxing, you're talking about the Fulmers, and specifically Gene.
They wanted to rename West Jordan as Fulmerville. Is it just because my dad had actually put Utah on the map, and West Jordan for sure. Is it a lot of people had no idea, especially from New York where Utah was at, let alone there was a little town named West Jordan, is it this humble little community.
Winner by unanimous decision and the new middleweight champion of the world, Gene Fulmer.
When Gene fought and beat Robinson, he put West Jordan on the map. He put Utah on the map. I think he put the LDS people had something that they can say, hey, Gene Fulmer's the middleweight champion. He's a Mormon.
The Fulmer brothers, toughest trio of boxers you could find anywhere. Three tough Mormons.
In Germany, when Dad fought Gustav Schultz, who at that time was the European middleweight champion, he was looking for a title fight with Uncle Gene, who was the world champion at that time. And Dad took the fight, and it was kind of promoted that, well, if you beat Don Fulmer, then you could maybe have a shot at his brother's title. And they did a promo, some publicity and stuff for the newspapers, and wanted Dad to drink Pilsner beer. Hey, Gustav Schultz, he drank Pilsner beer, and he's the European champion. That's what he drinks. And Dad said, no, I'll just have milk. And so when he refused to drink the beer, it came out the next day in the newspapers, Milk Baby Fulmer. And so the Mormon element was brought in there, and the reasons why he didn't drink beer, he drank milk instead.
Well, you know, Mother and Dad was always kind of religious, you know, we're LDS. We always went to church, and, so Sundays we got up and we went to priesthood, we went to Sunday school, we went to church, Sundays was a day of you went to church and you done your thing in church.
Well, I think for Utah and the Mormon church, it's one of the few places where you identify a state with a church. And so consequently, when a fighter came out of Utah he's adopted by the state. But they were what they said they were, and they tried to exhibit it in every way. And so I think for an identity for the region, it was really, really important.
Well, you know, Gene was got started and it was doing well. And of course, you know, being a brother, why we just kind of followed the suit, you know, and we started going to the gym and so forth, like I said, when I was about six or so. And it just kind of mushroomed into that. I figured that's what I wanted to do. And once I got, when I turned 18 years old, I decided it's time to turn professional. So I turned professional and started my professional career.
Farmer unleased a roundhouse that caught on.
I had a great opportunity. I mean, I traveled all over the world. I traveled a lot further than Gene ever did. Of course, Gene won the world championship, and I never quite made that. But I went overseas eight different times.
But Fulmer came very close in San Remo, Italy in 1968. Despite fighting off a bout of the Hong Kong flu, he nearly came home as a world champion.
We come here to fight. That's what we intend on doing tonight. We intend on taking that championship back to the United States.
So when Don fought Nito Benvenuti with the flu, he was a man on a mission. He didn't go over there to contend for this championship. He'd actually fought Benvenuti before and lost a close 10-round decision before Benvenuti had captured the middleweight championship of the world.
There will be no being saved by the bell. The count will continue if a man is knocked down and the bell rings until its termination or unless the fighter gets up, with the exception, of course.
I've never been so tired in my life. After that first round, I felt like I'd gone 15 rounds. Out of him, that right hand knocked him down. I think I was so tired, I don't think I realized what I'd even done. I let him get up and instead of really just walking right in and wailing on him, I don't know what I did.
When Nino hit the canvas, he was shaking his head trying to get those cobwebs out. He didn't know what had just hit him. It turned out to be a Don Fulmer right hand. Only problem is, back then it was a 15-round fight. And over those 15 rounds, with Don's stamina somewhat sapped from the flu, there was just nothing that he could do. He lost the decision. It did. It always haunted him. He always talked about how close he was to winning that championship.
Don Fulmer compiled a stellar record in the ring, but after 78 professional fights, it was time to call it quits. But he never could get past the loss to the Italian. Never closer to the title, and he could never quite forget the long list of good luck names sent to him before that title fight, or the plans for a parade, just like they had made when Gene won a championship. Part of the hurt is scrawled in Don's own handwriting, in his boxing scrapbook. "This was the biggest heartbreak in my life to this point," he scribbled after the loss. And when he did retire, nearly 5 years later, there it was again. Buried among thousands of newspaper articles, photographs, and stories about incredible victories in the ring. In his own words, Don Fulmer wrote, "I fought 9 world champions, held the American middleweight title, fought for the middleweight title December 14, 1968, in San Remo, Italy, against Nino Benvenuti, losing a 15-round decision due to the Hong Kong flu."
Nino Benvenuti in our family was also put up on a pedestal. And a couple years ago, the year before Dad died, we were at the International Boxing Hall of Fame in Canastota, New York. But Nino Benvenuti sat by my dad at the dinner, and at that time my dad had dementia. And, you know, kept repeating himself, and he would sit there and ask Nino Benvenuti how he was doing and how's his family and what he's doing now. And then he would repeat that, probably half dozen times, and I was getting a little bit embarrassed. And I reached over and said, "Dad, you're already asking that." Nino Benvenuti couldn't speak English very well, but he looked at me and says, "Let him go." And he leaned over to my dad and had my dad ask him the same question probably for the 10th time, because he knew my dad was having problems and he had that much respect for my dad. And so that was a neat thing to see.
So you can see it back in that position, sir. All right. Keep your right hand up. Right hand up there. I like that. So when you shoot that jab, you're trying to break it, though, not powder it, okay? So you just put his head in the washer.
You never see my dad without a smile and without being happy. And going over to the gym, he was always jovial, and he loved the kids. Every time he was there, there were big hugs from all the kids. They was always giving him hugs, and he was giving them hugs and wishing them good luck. And he loved being around that. He loved being involved with the kids. And so it was always great to see him, and all the Fulmer brothers were the same way. They loved being involved with the young people. And that's part of my dad's legacy, I think.
Teaching boxing skills was never difficult for Jay Fulmer. He knew how to box. Remember, there were three Fulmer brothers destined for greatness. And Jay Fulmer entered the ring with a brilliant boxing career just over the horizon, but sadly, out of reach.
Jay Fulmer being what all of the Fulmer brothers will tell you, the best pure boxer. Even Gene will admit that Jay was the one who had the stuff. Jay could get in and he could whack you three times and he could get out before you could land a punch.
Maselli misses a golden opportunity to damage Fulmer as Jay swings wildly, but Maselli isn't adapted to his speed and doesn't counter in time.
When Gene and Don was still fighting a little bit, I had to shorten my career a little early. Gene had 64 professional fights. Don had 79 professional fights. I had 27 professional fights. I had to cut mine a little short because I got injured some way. I didn't think I got hit that much, but evidently I did, because I was seeing double and they were both hitting me and I wasn't hitting either one of them. I thought that might be a good time to stop. And they told me if I kept fighting, I'd probably could go blind.
He talked about having to retire. It brought tears to his eyes. He truly, I think it devastated him when he had to stop. And his love for the sport and his desire was, you know, everything it needed to be. But physically, he knew that it was not a smart thing to continue.
They give me a choice. I came home, like I said, with Shelly, was 3 days old when I got home. I had a little gal that was a year old before her. So he's got to think, am I going to give up everything I've been working for all my life, for my family, for my kids? There wasn't a question. As bad as I wanted to, family come first.
Jay Fulmer was out of the ring, but not out of boxing. And growing up, Fulmer was not always easy.
When I graduated high school, I was 5'5", 120 pounds, you know. And so these kids had always come up, you know, and want to fight. And I don't know whether they had heard it from their parents or, you know, the Fulmer name, like I said, was so big. But they'd always want to fight me because I was the smaller kid. You know, and I'd ask them, what do you want? They said, well, I want to say I beat up a Fulmer.
Knowing that I'd grown up, you know, watching everybody fight, and as a little kid, you probably would be tempted to start fights and become a bully. My dad would tell me, he gave me a couple of rules. He said, number one, if I ever catch you starting a fight, you're going to get your butt kicked. But number two, if I ever catch you running away from a fight that another guy started, I'll kick your butt too. So there was a little bit of judgment call there, but there was a lot of respect there. And my dad made sure that I wasn't the one that was antagonizing people. And
picking up right where they left off in the first round.
The Fulmer brothers have dedicated much of their life after boxing to making life better for youngsters. Kids who might be having trouble, facing tough times, or they might be going through something Gene Fulmer experienced a long time ago when he was just a little skinny kid.
I was fairly small when I was growing up, and I got teased a little bit, and I wanted to stop that teasing and wanted the people to respect me for what I was rather than what they thought I was. It turned out right, and after I won the championship, a lot of people respected me more after that than they had before.
Okay, line up, guys.
Yeah, get snuggy, guys.
Well, after I met him, I couldn't imagine him being, you know, this middleweight boxer, and they always talked about how tough he was. Well, I could tell that he was very strong and a tough outer, but inside he's, you know, just the nicest person. You would never believe that he'd take on such a tough, grueling sport.
The reign at the top was surely sweet for Gene Fulmer and all his followers. But nothing is everlasting, and even for a champion, there are dark moments amid the ride to glory.
Right against the ropes, almost helpless. And then it's a go.
And Kid Perret, I'd fought him before he fought Emil Griffith when he got killed. I fought him and I probably beat him worse than I ever beat anyone before. I knocked him down two or three times and knocked him out in the seventh round.
He says, I tried. I did everything I could do to knock him out because I was just beating him, and I could tell that I was beating him bad. He says, as I would hit him in the ribs, I'd hit him in the stomach, and it felt like my hand was going all the way to my wrist.
Sad that it had to happen. I felt that it didn't have to happen. If they would have took some time between getting knocked out and getting another fight.
October 23rd, 1962, Gene loses the fight and his middleweight crown to Dick Tiger in San Francisco. His father-in-law, seated at ringside, suffers a heart attack during the fight and dies hours later.
About the second round or so, as my grandpa Holt had a heart attack. And as he sat there the rest of the fight, he did not want to disrupt the fight with his heart attack, not really letting anybody know what was going on. After the fight, told him as he wasn't feeling well, they took him in an ambulance to the hospital there outside of San Francisco, which where he died a few hours later.
And on the anniversary of his greatest victory in the ring, Gene Fulmer suffered his greatest loss outside of the ring, losing his wife Dolores to a heart attack.
The doctor, by the time I got to the hospital, the emergency, she had passed out, and she never did come to. I got her in the hospital, and she died not very long after I had her there.
They did everything they could to save her, but she was 51 years old and died. And it was 26 years to the day, probably almost to the hour, of when he won the championship from Sugar Ray Robinson as a back in Madison Square Garden. Being a fighter, my dad's fought through a lot of those things. It's a good thing that he's instilled that as in the rest of his family.
When the Fulmers stepped out of the ring as boxers, they didn't hang their gloves up. They just decided they would teach the sport and all that goes with it.
A clean punch is one that goes straight out, straight back, so you're not holding on and you're not any of this slapping.
Okay, you're doing great. Keep your hands up, look sharp, move out, boom, boom, boom.
Kids that do that, and we tell them, straighten that out, you know, and we'll slap you, and you know, and they, but they're, that's important. Straight punches, power punches.
Anything that was forced, but from the time we were 4 years old, you know, you had a pair of gloves on out punching dad in the stomach. That, you know, that's how we grew up training, basically, is you go out there and you drop your hand, you got to slap upside the head to teach you to keep your hands up. So early on, it was just kind of something. It wasn't forced, but it was just kind of, I guess, when you say expected, you didn't feel like it was expected, but it was just something you did.
When the boxing luster rubbed off, the Fulmers were forced to move their gymnasium several times, but they kept punching and always made sure the doors were open somewhere. Peek inside their gym and you see their magic in the air as they make their rounds like a healing ointment for the unvarnished side of life. A simple handshake, a pat on the back, an eyeball-to-eyeball conversation.
When I come down here, like, would you rather be locked up or would you want to be having fun doing stuff that can promote you in life? And I guess I'm choosing this.
I learn all this stuff you need to do boxing, like the jabs, the crosses, the straights, all the straights. Just teach me how to fight inside the ring and outside the ring and to defend myself. And the nice people, so I like to come down here and talk with Jay and all the other guys.
They've been in the corner for the poor kids, the kids who need a second chance, for those tossed aside by society. Like Jay Ferguson, who was always welcome with his wheelchair when he showed up at the gym. Like Arturo and Armando Robles, who had championship potential before they were deported to Mexico. Behind each picture, a story, a Fulmer brothers' backstory.
I'm Roberto Tamayo. I've been boxing since 1999. It's been a long, long journey, 13 years. I've had a rough childhood, so I think there's previous anger there. As I got older, I've analyzed and I grow. So I've realized that I was an angry person. And then to this day, I still am angry. But, you know, boxing has created an outlet for me to channel that anger towards something that's more productive. I don't think my dad had the skills to cope with that divorce. And so what ended up happening is that a month later after I came back from the Utah County Fair, my dad ended up murdering my mom and then committed suicide due to the divorce. From there, I kept staying busy with boxing, but it was just very hard because at that time I was barely hitting my point where I was like, okay, it's either you're gonna go down the wrong path or you're gonna go down the right path. Boxing was my right path. Everything else was going not as positive as I wanted. You know, I could thank the former family mainly for providing me such a secure place to always come to and not get judged on what I was doing or what I was doing. It's literally, I come here and it's like everything went out the door and my boxing comes right back in. It's like I never skipped a beat. And that to me is beautiful.
Ran into the Fulmers back in the early 70s, probably 73 or 74. And it was through the boxing and the area which I grew up in. I always wanted to be a professional fighter and they would take me aside and teach me that it wasn't about the boxing, it was about life and who you should be and how you should be acting. And they taught me a lot. Even to this day, I owe a lot to those guys in my family life and my relationship with my wife.
You know what, man? I've boxed all my life, and I was only doing it for fun. You know, life has changed. Now I have kids. You know, I'm not married. I'm gonna get married soon, though. Now I have somebody to fight for.
Representing the state of Utah, Julio Martinez.
I have that desire in me. I want to become a professional in something, you know? I want to be a professional dog. I didn't have the chance to go to school or any of this stuff, you know? I had to work since I was little. They're not doing this to get any money out of it. No, they're doing this to help the community. They're doing this to keep young people out of bad business. And I appreciate that as a person, you know? Because not everybody does that. Not everybody takes time out of their life to share with everybody else, to get them out of trouble, you know? That's what keeps me coming back here. They're my friends, they're always gonna be my friends.
No one knows how far Julio Martinez will go in boxing, but if you listen to his words, you begin to see the hand of victory already being raised. Boxing and family, that's the Fulmer way.
Their commitment is amazing. Their commitment that they've had for kids for so long. I mean, you know, after a while, some people get tired and it's enough's enough, you know. But these guys just have kept going and going and going. I've never seen, it's very difficult now to see Jay alone, where for years and years, they've always been together. You walk in and the three of them are always sitting together at the fights, and they're always introduced at the fights.
Right down here, yeah. Mr. Jay Fulmer.
You never know when you're gonna have a champion come out of here, and it starts right here. That's where it starts, the little kids about 3 and 4 years old. They don't become champions overnight. Gene didn't become a champion overnight. It took a lot of years in a ring just like this.
Decades after the championship days, long after the glory has faded, no matter where you go in boxing circles, bring up the Fulmer name, and a blue-collar, lunchbox, hard-nosed respect quickly settles into the conversation.
Their rich heritage in boxing is just a rich heritage for us. They have made immense contributions to Golden Gloves and amateur boxing in general.
You're both wrestling. You had a man who stands. You're wrestling. The next time it'll be a warning. Hank Kim, the third time.
There's nothing that compels someone like Gene or Don or Jay to stay in the sport of amateur boxing long after their glory days are over.
Well, we just try to help these kids out. We keep some of these kids out of jail. We referee for the whole week through the tournament. There's three rings set up for 3 or 4 days and fights going on all night long.
Where are you going, Gene?
Little Rock, Arkansas for the National Golden Gloves.
Anywhere you look in a ring, you'll see a Fulmer either judging or refereeing, and that's a testament to the dedication and the devotion that they have, and they continue to support this program.
But now these guys are chipping in, and there's a whole pair, bunches of them. At our last tournament, when we had the tournament in Salt Lake, I think there might have been 28 of them working at one time. And it was really a kind of in awe of how they have managed to keep that family.
We all just gather together and hang out.
And it's like a family reunion.
They wonder if Fulmerville came when we get there. There's a lot of Fulmers that go.
Humble and yet active, committed, and how much they'll work. They've even got their wives involved now. And I think we told somebody about the fundraising efforts that goes on within the organization. They want to do special things for student athletes. And so what a great thing it was that they have carried that on and made that a part of their virtual family. And we talk sometimes about like a one-man band. These guys are a one-family boxing program if you wanted to.
I'll see you about midnight, hon.
Yeah, he's being optimistic.
Maybe. Yeah, maybe 1 o'clock in the morning.
He's being optimistic.
Remember that long ago dream Tough and Mary Fulmer had for a champion? Well, in the ring and the record books, it came true. And outside of the ropes, in the tougher game, it has also been realized.
I think the legacy is that for those brief decades where boxing was central to the culture, that these young men from the west side of Salt Lake Valley were able, although small and without a lot of money and a pretty tiny little gym to work in, they were able to go to the biggest stages in America, perform well, win championships, and make the entire state and their religion very, very proud.
I think all this stuff together kind of puts us where we are today, and I just hope, I say, we're not better than anybody else and probably not as good as a whole bunch of them, but we're so lucky to have this surrounding where people now enjoy fighting and they hear that former name. So I think if we can just keep it going, one day they'll look back and say, yeah, I remember him, I remember him, and I remember him, and I hope it's my kids' kids that they remember.
Lots of people will remember. They will remember Gene, who punched past the bullies. They'll remember Jay, who kept his eyes on the prize. And Don, mourning the punch he never threw, they'll remember he kept smiling for another generation. The Fighting Fulmer Brothers, championing the underdog.
Thanks to Marv Jensen and the three Fighting Fulmer Brothers, the West Jordan Club is a howling success. 18-year-old Don is following in the footsteps of brothers Gene, former middleweight champ, and Jay.
Champion Gene Fulmer, West Jordan, Utah, and challenger Sugar Ray Robinson of New York City will battle for the NBA middleweight title.
Be trying to figure out this young and strong Gene Fulmer, the pride of West Jordan, Utah.
Robinson was lost! Robinson was hurt!
And the new middleweight champion of the world,
Don Fulmer, makes his pro boxing debut an impressive one to keep the name of Fulmer in the forefront of the middleweight ranks.
You just wait home for a phone call and wonder, you know, is he in the hospital or is he knocked out or did he win or did he lose or what was it?
And thank you very much to the Fulmer Brothers. You've been inspirational in the community, helping children in the Latino community.
Look sharp, move out, move, 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 and move around, okay?
It's two mighty mites are just going right at it.
You know, we help some of these kids out. That's what it's all about.
Holler at the kids and make them fight better. Hopefully.